and a new glass. Hey, beautiful. Give me a new glass, give me a new drink, I'm in. Anybody coming? You in? Beautiful. Let's say, what's going in the glass? I think the glass is called grace. I think it's the new covenant of grace. What's the new bottle? It's the new me. It's my new lifestyle. You know how it doesn't break? Like when somebody backs up to me and hits my car, I love them anyway. I forgive them anyway, because I got grace in my bottle. Now, what happens if I put grace in my bottle and they back up to me and I get out of the car? Are you out of your mind? My bottle has just broken. It's not holding my grace no more. Now I can't be a useful, my brother and I just joked about this back in the office. Now I can't be a useful vessel. I can't pour out. Why? Because you're supposed to pour out the grace I gave you, Phil. You just broke it because you got out of the car and yelled at her. You broke your vessel. You can't, there's nothing to pour. It's all over the floor now. So he's got to bust it. Because the truth is, I won't give up my favorite mug, and neither will you, church. He sends the wanderer. And whatever, we're talking about ideas and beliefs. And again, they will form, again, where you live determines how you live. I live by faith. It'll change how I live. The more I put God in, the more God should come out. The less I put God in, he doesn't come out as often as much. Hey, where's, he's like, he's ringing the bell. Hey, you coming out, Lord? I don't know how we confuse these things. And Moab shall be ashamed of Chemosh, as the house of Israel was ashamed of Bethel, their confidence. And of course, Moab, remember, Orpah left. Why did she leave? She said she wanted to go back to her God. Who was her God? Her God is Chemosh. That's the God of Moab's. Who was Chemosh? Well, he was, church, he was a big God. Forgive me. Very strong, very powerful God. Our God's bigger. Relax. I'm just messing around. But he's the God of control. He's the God of control. And that's what happens when you live in Moab. Listen, you got to be in control. What happens when you're not in control? Look at the country. Everybody thinks they're in control. Whatever branch of government you are, they all think they're in control. Right? They all think they're... Newsflash, none of you are in control. None of you are in control. But the problem is when you try and take my control or when I don't control, that's when the problems, that's when they come in, when I don't feel like I have control. Like, have you ever felt like you've got kind of a handle on life? There are times and moments in your life where you feel like you got a handle, like everything's okay. Why? Well, because it's in control. You think you're actually in control. That's the God of Chemosh. I'm in control. Right? And then the minute what happens, you said it last week, who moved the cheese? Chemosh is all upset now because you moved the cheese, man. He's not in control. That's the God of Moab. You're not in control. I mean, I hate to disappoint you, church, but you're not in control. Who's in control? Well, there's only one person that can be in control, God. Let's take a look at 1 Corinthians 15. Just me is warm in here. Verse 15, verse 28. And when all things shall be subdued, shall be in control. That's what that word means. Subdued, same thing, controlled. Unto him, God. Then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him, God. That put all things, that's us, pause, humanity, mankind, that's us, under him. That God may be all and in all. I rest my case. Who's in control? God. You have no control. You can't even control yourself, let alone anybody else. I can't control myself, so what makes me think I'm gonna control anybody else? Yet therein lies the problem with life. Therein lies the battles of life. Because I think I can control you. And when I can't do it righteously, what will I do? Well, now I'll figure out how to manipulate and deceive you somehow. But I'm going to control you, so help me, the God of Moab. God says, I'm taking him out, because otherwise, that's where your confidence is, by the way. Isn't that where our confidence is? Where should our confidence be? Yes, in God, in Jesus Christ alone, the Savior of the world. But for some reason, I feel like I gotta be controlled, or something's not gonna be right. Something's not just gonna happen. It's just the pieces won't fall into place otherwise. You're living in torment. You're living with this just oppression on you. For what reason, man? Man, God's got it, man. Now, it doesn't mean that, again, we are not vessels, and God can move me. And God does. I believe he does move us all. But for what purpose? To live in faith. To live by the Spirit of God. Not my lees, not my control. Maybe the very thing God's doing in our life today is actually taking away control. I don't want you to have any control. Did that thought ever cross anyone's mind but mine? I want you to have zero control over everything. So that the only thing you can do is come to me and hear my words and follow me and listen to me. I gotta get rid of your God. Man, I thought I was doing it in the name of God. I thought I loved him and served him, and I do. He's like, I know you do. I'm just cleaning house here, Phil. I'm just cleaning house. Nah, can't get through all this. I'm gonna have to skip through some of this. Forgive me. Let's go down to verse 37. For every head shall be bald. How many? Okay, we're all getting a haircut, church. Not just me. Y'all got to pay the price. Sorry, we're all gonna be bald. And what's he saying? He's gonna change the way we think. Again, because whatever the covering was, he's gonna change it. He's gonna have a new covering. I'm no longer gonna have this fleshly cover. I'm gonna have this faith cover. Amen? It's the tabernacle of Moses. What's the first thing you do when you go to the tabernacle? What's the first thing you do when you worship? Sacrifice. What do I sacrifice? Me. Boom. What goes on? I go on a sacrifice. That's what's on the grill. I burn it all. What? Flesh and blood. Boom. Get rid of it. What's the next thing I do? Now I jump into the bath. Boom. I go into the laver. What is that? I'm renewing my mind. It's the washing of the word. It renews my mind. Sacrifice first. Get rid of the natural man. Get rid of the flesh. And then do what? Boom. Now I live by faith. What's that? The word of God. It's the Spirit of God. You see that? Now I can go into the church. Remember, those are the first two things you had to do before you can go into the sanctuary. Hey, now I can go in and go to the church. Woo. Why? Well, first I got rid of my flesh, and then there was a renewing. There was faith. It was flesh, got rid of that, then it was faith. Amen? You see what I'm saying? Well, that's what he's doing here in this verse here, essentially, that you'll be bald, and every beard's going to be clipped. He's going to change my appearance. I'm not going to be this grouchy man getting out of my car. You ain't hitting my car. That's a rotten appearance, right? Oh, I'm so sorry. Are you okay? Like, and she was genuinely, like, she was like, oh, are you okay, baby? That was the first thing she said. Are you okay, baby? I'm like, as soon as she said that, I was like, oh, yeah, man, I'm good. How could you not feel good when someone calls you baby? It works. And all the hands shall be the cutting upon, and the loins, sackcloth. Again, it's the sackcloth. You die to that life. Paul said it all the time, I die daily. How, man, I'm still getting rid of the flesh, church. I'm still sacrificing it. Before I come in, Lord, burn it. Let me get washed up. Okay, now I'm feeling good. A little cologne. Okay, now I'm going to go have church. It's just always. It's ongoing. Like, I don't know. I don't know if there comes a day in my life where that's all. I don't know. I'm going to keep praying for it. But until then, I know the process. Burn it. Clean it. Go rejoice. Burn it. Clean it. Go rejoice. I think that's how you gotta live life. That's what he says right here. That's what he's doing. And here why? Here's why. Because again, he loves you, church. Verse 43. Fear and the pit and the snare shall be upon the inhabitants of Moab. When you live in Moab, that's what you get. Those are the benefits of Moab. Fear. A pit and a snare. If I don't get you out of there, your life's a wreck, man. Fear. What fear? You say, I don't fear nothing. Well, I pray you don't. I don't fear very much either. I used to, but I don't. Today, I honestly say, church, very little I really fear. I thank God I got delivered to that one. But what does fear mean? It's just the opposite of faith. It's just the opposite of faith. What is fear? Anxiety, worry, doubt, unbelief. It's fear. The opposite is faith. That's why he's telling you that. You got to live by faith, which fear is really just, it's just a fleshly thing. It's not a spirit thing. Now, the Spirit of God dwells inside of you, amen? So I don't have to live by that. I can live by the Spirit of God and say, no, it's faith. What's faith? Step one, trust God. Step one, trust God. That's faith. Step two, I'm giving you another, is this a mystery, I think, of the kingdom? Is that what you said, Sister Sandy? Here's a mystery for you. Number two, step two. All right, you don't want to take notes, that's fine. Step two, wait. I don't mean wait on the answer, that is the answer. Wait, you have to wait. You trust God, you wait. Step three, I'm not happy. Go back to step two. You haven't done that effectively yet. Wait. They that wait upon the Lord, he'll renew their strength. How do I get strength? I gotta wait. If everything I need, all I have to do is wait on God to get. Wait. Just wait on God. How long are you gonna wait? I don't know, church. This stuff, I've been waiting a long time for. I stay there. And when I go outside of the boundary lines, I say, oops. Thank God he's still gonna take my picture and put it on the refrigerator, but what do? Well, let me get back in the lines. Because I don't want to be out there because I got fear and a pit and a snare and I don't want to be there. I don't want to be there. And what's the pit? I mean, it's our mind, church. Proverbs says that the strange woman is as a narrow pit. Who's the strange woman? It's my soul. I don't know Jesus Christ. He's strange. I don't know him. Right, and so now I'm in this pit. I'm in this narrow pit and I can't get out. I'm stuck. How do I know him? Just call on his name. Say, Jesus. All you gotta say is, I need you, Jesus. Boom, congratulations, you just made a friend. You just made a friend. And then what's the trap? Man, I think the trap is the world. Psalms, I think 106 says that the idols I serve have now become my snare. What do you serve? I don't know. What do you listen to? If you listen to it, you serve it. If you listen to God, then great. If you listen to something other than God, like, I don't know, what is that? Is it fear? Is it money? Is it retribution? Is it justice? Then you serve, that's the God you serve. You're falling for the trap. That's the whole point. You're taking the bait, man. He says that in Amos also. When you read through that, I think it's Amos chapter 3. You might want to read that one. Don't take the bait, man. My Bible says in Ephesians chapter 2, where do we live? We are seated in heavenly places. Wait a second. What do you mean we're seated in heavenly places? The Bible says we're seated. I live my life by faith. I'm seated in heavenly places. Who else is in heaven? Yep, God, Jesus Christ. Yep, you can go on. Angels, yep, you can go on. You want access to them? Don't leave there. You're seated in heavenly places. Don't leave there. Live by faith. That's what he's saying. I'm not trying to accomplish it. I'm not waiting to get there. You are seated. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. Check it out if you don't believe me. I understand. You are seated in heavenly places. It's the only way he gets you out of this. I start living this. It's inside of me. The fear, the snare, the trap, it's all inside of me. Because I don't trust God. I won't hold on to God. I won't cleave to him. Instead, I run back to whatever it is I think might help me. I mean, surely there might be some kind of help. Right? The Lord helps those who helps himself. It's not in Scripture, church. I love when they throw that one at me. Whew. Trust in the Lord. Wait. Verse 47. Yet I will bring the captivity of Moab in the latter days, says the Lord. Thus far is the judgment of Moab. May the worship team if they'll come. He returns the captivity of Moab itself. Again, he's not after the people. What is he after? Where we live. Just don't live in Moab, man. Where should I live? In faith. In heavenly places. There is no condemnation. Let's live that one out. And generally, you know what is funny? It's just God. Don't we generally live that one out more often around this holiday season? Like, I don't know, maybe she was in the holiday spirit. I was kind of in the holiday spirit. Hey, praise God. If that's what it takes to bring about no condemnation, then praise the Lord. That's the acceptable sacrifice, though. Not us railing and doing whatever and just let God have it, man. I think he's just trying to get these last little things that I think, oh no, he got it all, and I have these little these little things that I think I have my finger on, my pulse on. It's my little sense of control. I got nothing. I got God, which means I got everything. Control, it's His. That's trust is true, 100% surrender to Him. And just say, Lord, I need to hear your word. I just need to hear from you. Church, that's all I need every day. I just need to hear from God. Once I hear, okay, everything's A-okay. And until I do, sometimes I just don't, where are you? I gotta hear you. Didn't David say that? If I had wings, I would fly. Why? I want to hear from you. I'm not hearing from you. Where we live will determine how we live. I pray we live as Christ. Amen? Why don't you stand while we close out?